Get that out of your head. The Greek actually means to carry. You can't. It's so heavy or it's so difficult. It's just so much that you can't carry it with you right now. And then Jesus goes on to talk about sending the Spirit of God to us so that we can carry and bear what it is that Christ has to give us. So that we don't carry it in isolation or alone. That is the gift of baptism. That, in a nutshell, is what baptism is all about. And it is in baptism that we see the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit at work, probably most poignantly in the church. When we talk about Holy Trinity Sunday, which, by the way, is what today is, we focus on the mystery that is the Godhead, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, or in more contemporary language, the Creator, Redeemer, and Sanctifier, who God is in relationship to one another and then to us. And so that's the question of Holy Trinity Sunday, and it comes on the heels of having this kind of evolution of the Godhead through the liturgical year. Now, this is my quiz for the morning. I'm going to see how... I'm going to turn this thing off. I apologize. That is really bright. Wow.
It is.
In any event, I have a quick quiz for you this morning. So get your liturgical worship hats on. What is the first season of the church year? Advent. Yes, you know. Advent. It's the one that happens way back in December. Remember December, November, late November, the early part of December, before the 25th. And then what comes after Advent?
Christmas.
12 days of it. Yep, Christmas. And then three wise guys show up, and that's the season of Epiphany. We got you guys have a big helper up here. Be sure to thank her later. She should shout them out of here. So there's this evolution of the church year of who God is. We begin with God the Father, Creator, and the Holy Spirit in the beginning with Christ's gestation in Mary, with that beginning in Advent, with that period of waiting for the revealing of the Christ child, the Savior. Then Christ comes. And then we walk with Christ, and Christ reveals more and more who God the Father and God the Holy Spirit are as they work through him. Pentecost is that day that kind of is the crowning moment where it all comes together and it all becomes transparent, because Jesus says, I'm going to send the Advocate, the Holy Spirit, to you, and he breathes upon his disciples, and they are filled with the Spirit. Or as we often read from Acts chapter 2, how the Spirit comes to each and fills them, and so they're speaking and babbling in strange languages. That was last week. Remember that part? Well, this week, now, we reflect on everything that just happened. Now's the day that everything comes together in our heads and begins to make sense. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, we have walked with them through the liturgical year, and now you get it, right? The Trinity, you guys could go out, you could tell the world what the Trinity is. Nobody would have any problems, right? You're ready to do it. I'm just getting blank faces. What does that mean?
That means it's 8 o'clock.
Means it's 8 o'clock. Okay. But this is the challenge of Trinity Sunday. There is still yet mystery to the Godhead, and that's why so many Christians often shy away from talking about God as Trinity. But it is the Trinitarian or triune God that we worship and believe and confess. Whenever we have the Apostles or Nicene Creed, each article of that creed, the first, the second, and the third, deals with some aspect or some person of God. The first, of course, is God the Father. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. That's simple. I think we got that one. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. We get Jesus. You know why we get Jesus? Because he, in some way, is like us. He takes on human form. We can relate to some of Christ's struggles. When Christ sees the righteous people and they make bad decisions, he weeps. When his friends die, he weeps. When he gets frustrated, he whips people out of the temple. When he dies, he grieves. He prays. There is a very human aspect of the Son of God in Jesus Christ that we get. So the Son is not the mystery to us. What happens, though, when we hit that Holy Spirit? We heard about the Holy Spirit the whole way back in Advent, when we heard about Mary becoming pregnant with Christ. The angel says to Mary, "The Spirit is going to descend upon you, and you will bear God's Son." We heard that the whole way back in Advent. And then throughout this year, we have heard repeated glimpses of the way the Spirit works through us and works in the world. So when we hear these words from Christ in chapter 16 of John, and by the way, I love, this is kind of the longest death scene and resurrection scene ever. Jesus says way back on the evening in which he is betrayed in the Gospel of John, "I'm going away." And then for chapter 14, "I'm going away." And then chapter 15, "I'm going away." And then he goes away. And then he comes back in 16 and says, "I'm still going away." It just keeps happening over and over and over again. It's the longest death and resurrection and return scene you've ever had. But the beauty of it is that we have this wonderful exposition from Christ to explain to us how the Spirit will help us. That the Spirit is the one through which we are able to carry the Word of God into the world. That it's something that you and I cannot bear on our own. In Romans, Paul writes that we fail in our words. And when we fail, the Spirit of God which is in us speaks for us with sighs too deep for even words to express. Paul writes further that when we feel that stress and that strain and that bondage to sin, that it is the Spirit of God within us that cries out to the Father to be redeemed, to be recognized, to be made child of God. So we don't carry all this stuff on our own. Now, being good American folk, and I'm looking at him, guessing that's who you are, you have a real ingrained sense of independence. It's kind of how we're made as Americans. I am so guilty of that and fascinated by my own ability to claim that I don't need help when I really do. Is there anyone else here like that, or am I by myself here? Oh, good, okay. So knowing that the Spirit of God is with me and within me and able to help me, when I am being my baser self and connects me and binds me to the larger church, my brothers and my sisters in Christ, means that I am not alone. But how do I know that? How do I see it? How do I experience it? I think because we are Americans, we are strange Christians in a way, because we proclaim our independence at the same time that we are deeply, deeply dependent upon one another. When our words fail us, it is the Holy Spirit within the community of faith that cries out on our behalf. One of the first things I heard when I walked into the church this morning was, "The prayer list is long." It is tempting, when we hear a long prayer, to shut up our eyes and our ears and start to go to the grocery list and the to-do list and all the other lists in our head of things going on while the person up here is yammering away and saying names and going on and on and on. It's so tempting. But the community of faith relies upon us to be attentive to all aspects of need within the community. And the very basic of those needs are our prayers. Allowing the Spirit of God that is within us to reach to God on behalf of others is one of the most primal and essential pieces of being a brother or sister of Christ. But there's one other quirky little thing about being an American Christian. We are very funny about our money. Yeah? I know this to be true because as a living, what I do for the church is I meet with people to help them prepare gift plans, meaning that as you look at your life going forward from this day, if you were to die tomorrow, all that stuff you have prepared, as it says in Luke chapter 12, and Jesus asks us, whose will it be? What's it for? What's its intention? Now, if you're like me and you're a Central Pennsylvania girl, you were raised with the attitude that you pass on the family farm. Any family farm folk here with me? I know there's a couple of you out there. Yep, there you are. What you do is you get your stuff, you inherit it from your grandmother or grandfather, your mother, your father, your aunt, your uncle, and your job is to take care of it, make it grow, and then pass it on to the next generation. That's what the family farm thing is, right? That's how we do. However, there's a wrench in the works, and that is this. Even our money, along with our prayers, are intended not for the family farm, not for our own gratification, not for the enrichment of our family and friends, but rather to proclaim the word of God in the world. That's its job. Every gift and resource we have from God, from this Godhead, this Trinitarian Godhead, every resource, every gift is intended to proclaim the word of God. Now, if you're like me, you may think money is kind of just a tool. It's a resource. It's something that I'll steward, I'll take care of, I'll pass along. But it's so much more than that. Just like the prayers that we offer, our money has the power to proclaim the word of God. For example, the Evangelical Lutheran Church in America, foundation which I am a part of, sponsors an endowment fund. And in that endowment fund, there's nearly $600 million. We steward that fund. And we do it in a way that proclaims God's word on Wall Street. Now, how do we do that? By the choices that we make in investments and by using our voice in proxy votes, and when things are going horribly wrong with a company, we have the power, because we got the money, to sit down with someone and say, the way your company is making choices is wrong. And we invest according to all those social statements. Remember all those social statements we've been passing in the church? There's all sorts of social statements. One on creation. There's one on genetic testing. There's one on economics. There's one on human resource. There's tons, the death penalty, you name it. Tons and tons and tons of social statements in the church. All those social statements help to guide how the church invests its money. That's how we proclaim the word of God. We don't just act like everyone else. We are in it just for the money. We're in it to proclaim the word of God in a place that would rather we chose to live like the world, by the world's rules. So we play the world's rules, but we proclaim the word of God in that place by the choices we make, and so do you. Whenever we see a place and we talk about economic boycott, or we talk about issues of whether or not to divest from a country or from a place, or whether or not to economically rescue a place that's about to be bankrupt, every choice that we participate in, both as country and as individuals, is a part of our proclamation as God's people. It's not just stuff done in isolation. It's the reason why You may choose to buy something that's made in America as opposed to made in China. You may think you're trying to support your local economy rather than a Chinese economy. Those are the decisions that we make because we're trying to constantly weigh how do we help our neighbor. It's not about exercising our own morality. Don't confuse economic justice with morality. There's a difference. Justice is siding with the oppressed. Let me say that again. Justice is siding with the oppressed. Not making a moral judgment about whether or not what they do is right or wrong, but standing with those who are cut off from the rest of society, those who are on the fringe, those who are on the outside. That's what a Christian does. You know how I know that? Because Christ stands with sinners. And those are the people that are outcasts from heaven. And Christ stands with the sinner and dies for the sinner and is resurrected and claims the sinner and fills the sinner with the Spirit and entrusts to us through the Spirit the carrying of that kind of word and justice into the world, this true proclamation of God's love. And that's how we execute our choices through our finances, through our prayers. And how do we know? But we look to one another for help in discerning those places where we need to be praying, those places where we need to be investing, those places where we need to have energy and care for those who are on the outside. One of the best lectures I ever had in seminary was after a year's worth of theological classes. And I was in the last class on the last day, and my one professor, who was one of those guys who would talk up here, and the rest of us were somewhere around here. And on the last day, all he did was he drew a great big circle on the board. And he said, "This is the community of faith, and God is over here." Wherever we draw lines among human beings, among creation, wherever we set ourselves apart from one another, and we refuse to walk with anyone, regardless of their status or what they have done, or whether or not they were right, or whether or not they were wrong, or whether or not they hurt us. Whenever we choose to not walk with someone who is outside of our circle, for whatever reason, then we deny the Spirit within us to cry out in love to the other. We allow our choices to go to our baser selves, to watch out for ourselves first and our own point of view and our own cares and our own concerns, when God is calling and crying out from within us to run, flee, go to our neighbor, to support, to care, and to love. That is the challenge of the Christian faith. And when Christ stands among us and says, "I still have many things to say to you, but you cannot carry them now. You cannot lift them up now, but I will send the Spirit to help you." The day you were baptized, you were filled with the Spirit of God so that you too could walk and to bear with one another all that the world would have us carry, so that we can make another's burdens lighter. This isn't about liking the world. It's not about living as the world lives. This is heeding the call of Christ through the Spirit of God as we have been created by the Father. to be that which God made us to be from the day that Adam and Eve appeared in that garden. To be focused and centered on God alone and God's will for us. And that will, what is it that God wills for us? Well, in this same gospel, 10 chapters prior to today's reading, Jesus says, God's will is that you would believe in the one who was sent. The Spirit of God has been sent to you. Amen.
Amen.